Nous abordons la session 1.3, promouvoir l'intégration, l'équité et la mixité dans le processus de continuité éducative avec M. François Soulages. M. François Soulages est président du collectif Alerte. Je suis très, très heureuse de vous accueillir. Vous êtes un engagé, un économiste, fondateur de l'Institut du développement de l'économie sociale, président de Chrétiens en Forum, diplômé de sciences politiques et membre du Parti socialiste. Vous avez été conseiller municipal de Nanterre, délégué interministériel à l'économie sociale en 1982. Vous fondez ensuite l'Institut du développement de l'économie sociale, l'IDES, et vous devenez le président. Vous plaidez et agissez pour faire de la solidarité une véritable priorité et pas que gouvernementale. La transition vers l'école peut représenter un défi de grande envergure pour les enfants issus de familles défavorisées, de milieux autochtones, culturels et linguistiques différents. Si on considère les points de vue des enseignants, des enfants et des familles et des professionnels de la petite enfance, quelles études permettent d'étayer et d'approfondir cette question de la continuité éducative pour les enfants à besoins particuliers? Voilà, j'appelle M. François Soulages qui va venir animer, modérer cette session. Merci beaucoup.
Merci Nathalie de cet accueil. Nous avons en fait un peu de chance avec cet atelier parce qu'il va prendre assez directement la suite du précédent. Parce que, par exemple, je viens d'entendre toute l'importance de l'implication des parents dans cette continuité éducative. On ne peut pas faire en sorte que l'enfant soit traité comme une personne seule. La question des parents est une question fondamentale. Et puis, et nous allons regarder, avec l'intervention de M. Craig Alexander, la question de l'éducation, parce qu'ils appellent l'éducation... J'arrive pas à trouver le mot français. Enfin, le processus d'éducation en continu, c'est-à-dire la nécessité qu'il y a aujourd'hui pour une société de prendre les enfants le plus tôt possible dans un processus continu parce que ceci est important pour la suite, non seulement de leur vie d'adolescents et d'adultes, mais parce que ceci est important pour l'ensemble de la société. Alors, de ce point de vue, d'ailleurs, vous allez voir que les données recouvrent celles que nous a indiquées M. G. à l'instant. C'est d'ailleurs intéressant parce que M. Craig Alexander arrive du Canada, M. Jay parle de la France. Mais il y a là une continuité. Voilà. Alors je voulais simplement vous dire ça parce qu'il faut écouter ce qui va vous être dit par notre intervenant à la lumière de ce qui s'est fait au Canada et dont il dit lui-même d'ailleurs que ce n'est pas exactement ce qui se fait en France. Alors au moment où notre gouvernement indique la nécessité de la scolarité dès 3 ans, il faut se méfier d'une chose, c'est qu'on se dit, on va commencer à s'occuper des enfants à travers le scolaire à 3 ans. Alors, la continuité éducative, elle commence avant. Même s'il faut se réjouir de la scolarité à 3 ans, et vous allez voir en quoi cela nous intéresse, parce que c'est autre chose, la scolarité à 3 ans et la scolarité à 5 ans, mais il ne faut pas oublier comment ils arrivent là, d'où la question de l'équité. Et c'est pour ça qu'on est intervenu notamment avec des intervenants sur les populations autochtones. Parce que tout le monde ne peut pas accéder de la même manière. Et donc, accepter, c'est pour ça que le mot équité est un mot important, accepter la différence dès le démarrage. Et ça, les politiques publiques ont un petit peu de mal. Parce que ce dont je vous parle, c'est l'actualité que je vis actuellement. Puisque tout à l'heure, en vous quittant, je rencontrerai M. Olivier Noblecourt, que vous avez vu ce matin, sur ces questions. Et je crois que les arbitrages dans notre gouvernement, en tout cas, ne sont pas encore rendus. Voilà. Alors, M. Craig va faire une intervention à partir notamment d'une étude qu'il a faite à partir de l'éducation de la petite enfance, à travers laquelle il va vous montrer tout l'intérêt qu'il y a, y compris parce qu'il m'en a parlé tout à l'heure, on a réussi à mettre en évidence de l'impact, parce que toutes nos études aujourd'hui nécessitent des études d'impact. Or, il va vous démontrer, ce qui n'est pas encore le cas en France, quel est l'impact de cette éducation pour la petite enfance. Bon, Monsieur Craig, mais vous l'avez dans votre document, vous savez à peu près qui il est. Il est aujourd'hui le vice-président et économiste en chef du Conference Board of Canada et il supervise actuellement le département d'économie de ce Conference Board du Canada. Mais surtout, ce qui est important, c'est qu'il a travaillé sur cette question de l'éducation dès le plus jeune âge, et c'est là-dessus que nous l'entendons avec un grand intérêt.
Thanks very much. I have to say it's an enormous privilege to be presenting to you today. I have spent my entire career reading OECD research. I have read hundreds of their reports over the years, so it's incredibly kind to have the opportunity to actually present at one of their forums. It does come with a downside, though, because I went to the bookstore during the lunch, and now I'm worried that I'm going to exceed my baggage allowance weight on the way home. What I'm going to do is I'm going to talk a little bit about the economic impact of early childhood education and drive home the importance from an equity point of view. Now, we've heard a lot about equity, inequality issues, right? The gap between the outcomes that kids from disadvantaged backgrounds are having versus kids from higher income backgrounds. And when you have that conversation, it sounds like limiting that gap is a fairness issue. And in truth, it may indeed be a fairness issue. But I'm here to talk about the fact that this is of economic importance, that there is an economic imperative to addressing this issue. So, with that, one of the big issues that we're seeing on the global stage today is rising income inequality. And it is happening around the world, it is happening throughout all of the advanced economies to varying degrees. And what we can see is that this is having a, you know, if we look back in time, economists typically didn't worry about income inequality. Because the assumption was when the economy grew, jobs would be created, incomes would rise for everyone to varying degrees, but everybody would benefit. In other words, a rising tide would lift all boats. But what we've discovered is that high levels of income inequality, particularly if they're sustained for a long period of time, can actually cause real economic harm. And I think some of the big political issues we have today are showing that. If you look at the voting patterns for Trump, or the voting patterns for Brexit, or you look at the increasing vote for some extreme parties, it's indicative of the fact that many people don't feel like the system is working for them. They aren't benefiting from the growth that we've seen in the economy. In Canada, we have seen rising income inequality as well. What is notable about the Canadian experience is the big jump happened in the mid-1990s, and that coincided when the government of Canada was having a major fiscal challenge. It had a debt crisis, a little like what Europe had between 2010 and 2013. And during the period when the government was cutting back on transfers to individuals and it was starving the education system for funding, you saw an enormous jump in income inequality. But what was amazing was that when the transfers were restored, income inequality in Canada didn't decline. It stayed elevated. So to me, this actually sends a pretty powerful message that one of the things governments need to do is constantly be looking to lean against the tendency for income inequality to rise. And when we look at in terms of the income gains, and this is something that is true across the advanced economies, is that when you look at the distribution of income, what you can see is that the top end of the income distribution has been getting the bulk of the income gains that have been present. Middle income families in most of the advanced world have actually seen very stagnant wage growth. And I think this is partly why you're hearing about the dissatisfaction about the outcomes. You know, people aren't seeing the rise in the standard of living they were expecting, and so they're lashing back against the outcomes they're having. And at the same time that the middle class has sort of been having relatively flat outcomes, we continue to be worried about the level of poverty. We worry about disadvantaged families. We worry about the poverty trap and the inability of households to break out of them. And when we look at poverty rates in North America, they are higher than in Europe. Canada, in general terms, is sort of this country that is somewhere between the European and the U.S. experience on most things. You know, income inequality in Canada higher than a lot of parts of Europe, but not as high as the United States. Poverty, same sort of story. So one of the questions when you look at this is you have to ask yourself, like, okay, so why is this happening? Right? What is causing this outcome? And we need to understand that we're in a world where there are tectonic changes taking place. The structure of the economies are changing, and they are having a very big impact on the labor market, and that's having a very big impact on the outcomes that households are having. This is impacting their standard of living. One of the factors that gets a lot of blame is globalization. And it is absolutely true that globalization has meant that we now have a world economy. You know, companies can produce anywhere in the world. So they can choose the lower cost labor center to do the production. And as a consequence, we have seen that contribute to job losses for a lot of good quality, you know, middle wage jobs in Europe, in Canada, and abroad. Now, this has benefited the developing world. It's actually reduced global income inequality. It's created lots of prosperity, but it has created a challenge because some people have not benefited from globalization. And this is where you get sort of the threat of protectionism that Canadians worry so much about, because we're a small trading nation, you know, saddled beside the United States. You know, to put Canada in context, we're basically California with really bad weather. You know, our population is a little smaller than California, our GDP is a little smaller than California, but Canada is spread across the entire northern border of the United States. So each province does more north-south trade than east-west. And as a consequence, you know, the rise of protectionism in the United States causes Canadians to feel very, very anxious about where the world is going. But in point of fact, globalization has not been the predominant driver to the disruption that we've had in the labor market. Technology has. You know, for every job that's been disrupted from globalization, 4 to 5 have been disrupted through technology. And technology is fundamentally changing what employers are looking for. It's changing the skills that workers need to have. And so if you look at job creation in Canada and the United States, what you can see is that virtually all the net job creation has been in high-skilled positions. In the US, there's been an increase in low-skilled employment, but there's been a decline in the middle-skilled job. And that's the story about the hollowing out of the middle class. And at the same time, the technology is also changing the nature of the labor market. So we're seeing a shift in the type of work available. And so the pace of growth in temporary jobs or contract jobs has been twice the pace of full-time permanent jobs in Canada. And so you have the rise of what gets called the gig economy, right? Where, you know, there's more precarious employment. So you might be wondering, well, what the heck does this have to do with early childhood education? Like, why am I up here talking about, you know, technology and globalization and technical and skills changes? Well, the reason is because investments in early childhood education can be a meaningful part of the solution, right? If we think about how do you address income inequality, the one that people naturally tend to latch onto is higher taxation, right? You get this from you hear about the talk about the 1% versus the 99. I actually think that's a really unconstructive conversation because it makes it sound like there's a simple solution. It's easy, just take away income from the 1% and give it to the other 99. Well, unfortunately, you run into a math problem here. Because if you take 90% of the income away from the top 1% and you give it to everybody else, you barely reduce income inequality as measured by the Gini coefficient, because by definition, there's so few people in the 1%. Now, that isn't to say we don't need to have progressive taxation. I actually do think we need to have a very progressive tax system that leans against income inequality. But it isn't going to be the silver bullet. In fact, what you need is constructive policies to remove barriers to opportunity. And this is where we immediately get into conversations around early childhood education and how do we remove barriers from disadvantaged kids and how do we deal with those that face barriers in terms of climbing up the income scale? And how do we make a resilient labor force that can cope with the technical change that's coming? Like, when we think about the kids that are getting early childhood education today, the labor market of the future is going to look completely different than the labor market they have today. And boy, they had better be resilient. They had better be adaptable. And if they want to succeed, we're going to need them to be as skilled as possible. There is another dimension to this that's an economic imperative, and quite frankly, I could do this whole presentation on the basis of demographics. With an aging population, you hear a lot of commentary about the countries being trapped in a slow growth environment, right? Since 2008, you've heard a lot of lamenting about Europe, the US, Canada, and other countries being trapped in a sustained slow growth environment. In point of fact, because of an aging population, this is about as good as it gets for economic growth, right? So when I started my career, we used to think 3% growth each year in Canada was average. Now the long-term sustainable rate is a little under 2%, and that's because of demographics. So that means what you need to do is get the most out of every potential worker you have. And if we look at the academic work, you can see it very clearly that access to affordable, quality early childhood education will get more mothers into the labor market. And this can really boost labor participation for women and reduce income inequality. So we've covered a lot of ground on the early childhood front throughout today, and I don't want to be hugely repetitive. So, we all agree that investments in early childhood education can bring, can upskill kids, can give them benefits, help them get ahead. When we think about school readiness, one of the things you see in the literature around the impact of early childhood education is there is a wide range of assessments on the impact on skills. But there's a lot more agreement that kids that go through effective, high-quality early childhood education programs have fewer behavioral problems when they enter the public school system. And so, in my mind, regardless of whether you look at it from a skills point of view or not, on the behavioral side, there is no question that kids that go through effective ECE programs are far more ready, prepared to go into the public education system. But we also know it does correlate to skills. And we know that higher essential skills lead to better outcomes. If you have stronger literacy skills and numeracy skills, you're more likely to finish high school, you're more likely to go on to post-secondary education, you're more likely to get a job, your duration of unemployment, if you experience unemployment, is significantly less. You're more likely to do lifelong learning. And as I said, with the technology that's coming down the pipeline, you have to constantly be upgrading your skills. So this, essential skills are fundamental for the world we're heading into. So when we look at Canada, and we did our study on early childhood education and the economic impact, one of the things that really came out of our work was a focus on the duration that kids are in the programs. Because one of the things we know from the literature is that the impact of being in a good quality program for multiple years has a far greater impact than just the, one plus one, right? So, multiple years give you greater benefits. So Canada's around the OECD average when it comes to enrollments at age 5. This is before the grade 1, this is what we call kindergarten. But when we look at age below 5, what we suddenly find is that Canada is way behind. Now, Canadian kids actually score really well on the OECD PISA surveys in terms of educational performance. And so a lot of the work shows that, kids that don't get good quality early childhood education, often on the skills side, they catch up. But there's a good question about how much resources have to go into helping that child catch up. In fact, we think that you could actually take a lot of strain off the public school system if you actually prepared kids with high quality early childhood education and had it more universal. So we looked at how many more kids would we need to put through our early childhood programs, and we compared it, if we wanted to hit the OECD average, we'd need to open up 134,000 spots. But I gotta tell you, in the world we're in and the world we're going to be in, I don't wanna be average on education. Right? You'd much rather be at the top end. And so what we're basically advocating for is, increasing enrollment in early childhood education in Canada very significantly. If we move up to the top end of the OECD countries, we're talking about 400,000 spots. But like I said, there's the impact on the child, which we think will pay off in higher skills and make a more resilient workforce, but there's also the impact on women and labor participation. And we also know that there's a gender dimension to this. There's a gender wage gap that is related to the fact that a lot of women take time out of the labor force when they're after having children. And the longer they're out, the bigger the wage gap is, and it's really hard to catch up when you're behind. And so if we want to narrow the wage gap, if we want to have better equity, gender equity, we actually think that investments in early childhood education could play a big part in helping achieve that goal. So when we look at the labor participation rate for women with kids in Canada, it's around 75%. But the OECD average is over 80%. And if you go to the top end of the scale, it's even higher than 80%. So just modeling that, you know, the bottom line is that Canada could probably, if we went to the OECD average, we think we could have another 58,000 women in the labor market, you know, upwards to 77,000 if we actually move towards the top end of the spectrum. These are meaningful at a time when when 40% of Canadian employers are saying they're having skills shortages. You know, they can't find the workers with the skills they need, and you have a lot of women with skills that would be in demand. There's been lots of academic studies done on the cost-benefit analysis. I certainly agree with Sir Kevin Collins' remark today about the fact that you should never look at one study and say, well, that's the study I'm going to count on. Right? But if you look at all of the studies that have been done, right, here's our estimates from the modeling my group does. All of the studies show that every dollar you invest in early childhood education has a significantly greater than $1 return over the lifetime of the investment. And a big chunk of that return actually comes from the increase in labor participation of women, and that happens very, very quickly. So you get a lot of the benefit immediately, and then the rest of the benefit you get over the lifetime of the child. And this is often where the fiscal problem comes up, right? Because large-scale expansions of early childhood education can be expensive. And, you know, the benefits extend beyond the term of a government. And so the governments, you know, often find it hard to make these long-term investments. But at the end of the day, if we want to compete, if you want to have a competitive economy, you want to be able to compete on the world stage, increasingly companies compete on the basis of talent. And so if you want to succeed in the world of the future, you need the most skilled workforce possible. And so we do think governments should invest more in this area because it has one of the highest rates of return. At the conference board, as mentioned, I run an economics division. I run a group of 42 economists. And what we do is very technical quantitative modeling. We have a model for the Canadian economy, all of the provinces, all of the industries, all of the cities. And what we do is, you know, my primary job is I'm an economic forecaster, which I have to say in the age of Trump is terribly entertaining. And when you do the economic forecast, we have to plug in things like, what do you think labor participation is going to be? What do you think what's going to happen to employment? What do you think is going to happen to unemployment? And so we can actually do a lot of work around, you know, what impact does raising human capital have on the economy? And so from our models, when we did the estimates and we pushed through, you know, the upskilling of kids, but also the increase in labor participation for women, what we found was a significant decline in income inequality amongst families with children. It's not a game changer. You can't, you know, like just as I said, the tax system won't solve income inequality. Investments in early childhood education are also not going to solve income inequality. But as a package of programs designed to lean against rising income inequality, to try and limit how bad income inequality gets, you know, a progressive tax system is part of the solution, but so too is investments in things like early childhood education. I often get pushed by groups in Canada about, should we be investing in kids or should we be investing in adults? Because right now we have labor shortages. The answer is yes. Every company I know that only focuses on the next quarter is bound to fail. And every company that sets a long-term goal and pays absolutely no attention to what's happening in the market today is gonna fail. So you absolutely have to have a balanced approach in terms of investing in in kids and investing in adults. So, it says 27 seconds. I am astonished that I didn't go over, because this will be the first presentation in years I have not gone over, and I look forward to your questions.
Pour l'économiste que je suis, ça fait plaisir de sortir de simplement des aspects psychologiques ou simplement éducatifs, mais qu'on puisse arriver grâce à ces études à avoir aussi un impact économique, parce que tout ça se traduit par des décisions budgétaires. Donc je remercie beaucoup M. Alexander, il nous donne des éléments que nous allons essayer avec Nathalie en particulier d'utiliser dans nos responsabilités actuelles. Merci encore. Alors, je vais maintenant appeler les personnes qui vont participer à ce panel. D'abord, j'appelle Mme Andrea Jung. Alors, Mme Andrea Jung, elle vient de professeure de linguistique à Strasbourg. Mais moi, ce qui m'intéresse, c'est votre approche du plurilinguisme. Parce que franchement, si on a bien un problème de la mondialisation dont on parlait, c'est bien la question du plurilinguisme et de ce que ça veut dire en termes d'éducation. Parce que le traitement en équité, enfin, on le voit en tout cas dans notre pays, bute sur ce problème du plurilinguisme. J'appelle également Mme Angela James. Alors, Mme Angela James, elle a une expérience dans les populations autochtones. Et là encore, on voit bien cette difficulté que nous avons aujourd'hui. Voilà, venez vous installer. On voit bien les difficultés qu'on a aujourd'hui, y compris chez nous, avec des populations de cultures différentes. Alors, on n'est plus dans le problème du plurilinguisme, on est vraiment dans le problème d'approche culturelle. J'espère qu'elle va pouvoir un peu nous éclairer comment on soutient les enfants de la naissance jusqu'à la transition vers l'école, en tenant compte, en effet, de parcours qui peuvent être des parcours différents. Monsieur Olivier Thévenon, alors là, j'ai beaucoup de respect avec Monsieur Olivier Thévenon, où est-ce qu'il est? Je l'ai vu tout à l'heure, il est là. Monsieur Olivier Thévenon appartient au Haut Conseil de la Famille, et donc il est un peu comme nous, il essaie d'aider notre gouvernement dans les décisions qui doivent être prises. Il a un portail sur le bien-être des enfants. Alors là, voyez-vous, sur le bien-être des enfants, on n'est plus tout à fait dans la dimension économique, mais c'est intéressant de pouvoir faire le lien entre les deux. Et puis, Madame Nirmala Rao. Alors, Madame Nirmala Rao, elle aussi, elle vient de... Alors là, vous venez de loin, puisque vous venez de Hong Kong. Mais je sais que vous avez, depuis très longtemps, influé sur les décisions politiques qui sont prises en matière d'éducation dans toute la zone Asie-Pacifique. Et donc, je vous remercie d'avoir accepté de venir nous rencontrer. Voilà. Alors, Madame Andrea Jung, ben, écoutez, à vous. Vous savez que vous avez une règle impérative, c'est 7 minutes, j'en suis désolé. Mais on va essayer de tenir le temps. Voilà. À vous.
Thank you very much for inviting me here this afternoon. I've worked on these questions of linguistic and cultural diversity with children at school for over 20 years now, and I've worked with European colleagues and colleagues from North America and Japan, and all our studies show that the importance of the child's first language in their development is absolutely primordial. Yeah. Not only in their language development, which means that they lean on their first language, they build on their first language to learn the second language or the language of education, as the work of Jim Cummins has shown everybody in Canada, but also in terms of their cognitive development, they have a greater metalinguistic capacity, competence, than children who are monolingual. They are able to better understand concepts if they are allowed to use their first language. The problem is that we, in France, I work in France, we are very often living with this myth that you need to evacuate the first language in order to give room to the second language, which is totally unfounded. There's been many, many reviews of research, and a recent one by Augustin Shanahan, which has shown us that it's absolutely not the case that children, of course, as we all know as educators, build on what we know. And therefore, the first language, as the first language of socialization, the language of the family, the language of the heart, as many people would say. We heard this morning about the family link and the effect and the construction of identity, how this first language is so important in this. So all these factors mean that if we deprive a child of the use of their first language, and then unfortunately this is still happening today, that many well-meaning professionals who are not in the know-how still say to parents, speak the language of schooling, regardless of what capacity these parents have in the language of schooling. But if we deprive the child of using their first language to build on what they already know, then we're actually disempowering them. Their first language is a very important cognitive tool. And if we are not allowing them to use this language and not allowing parents to use this language, we're effectively silencing them and disempowering them. The second point that I'd like to make is that we've heard already today that it's really necessary to work with families, with parents. Parents are co-educators, they're the principal partners. We need to join forces to work in the same direction. Families seek advice from professionals. They see professionals as experts, and they will ask them, what should I do? Should I continue speaking my home language? Should I abandon my home language? And once again, we're disempowering these families if we are telling them to use a language in which they are not comfortable and which they do not have the capacity to raise their children effectively in this language. It's where is this coming from? Well, there's a lot of fear out there. There's Gogolan, who works in Hamburg, has talked about a monolingual habitus. Many of our teachers are unfamiliar with what it is to function as a bilingual person or a bicultural person or a plurilingual person. And we heard also today that we base a lot of what we do on what we have ourselves experienced, yeah? So it's not their fault when they don't understand how things work, especially if they haven't had training in these areas. So there's a lot of fear, and that's understandable, to go towards somebody who doesn't speak the same language as you, to try and talk to children who can be sometimes distressed because of leaving parents, etc. Trying to talk to them when you do not share a language, it is very, very difficult. And this is what leads many professionals to ask parents to ditch, effectively, their first language. Central importance then, of course, is the high quality of training for professionals. Now, in France, we've had a national policy since 2015 to include children's languages at preschool, to recognise them and to actually work with them and to share them in the classroom so that they're for everybody's benefit. But this is not filtering down to the classroom. There's a gap between the top-down policy and the bottom-up enactment of that policy. I've said it's through fear, it's through lack of knowledge. Banks, who is a researcher who works in Northern America on intercultural education, says that to be an effective educator, you need to know, to care, and to act. Well, knowledge is important, that's for sure. Knowledge about language awareness of how children acquire language, how they develop second language. But it's not enough. I think nearly all professionals care, but there's this element of empathy as well. If you have never yourself experienced what it is like to try and learn through a second language and to be in two worlds, effectively, which are disconnected, then it's difficult for you to put yourselves in the shoes of that child. So I think there needs to be work on empathy. This can perhaps be done through testimonies, through using film in education programs. But then, of course, is the act, which is the all-important thing. It's taking that step, it's taking that risk, as we heard this morning, to go towards children and towards parents with whom you do not share a language. Knowledge is not enough. How do we do this? I think as researchers and teacher educators, our role is to support professionals, to support parents, to accompany them. I think we need whole school approaches rather than single person approaches, and I think that participatory research has a role to play here. And here I do think that governments have a role to play, because participatory research needs funding. We need funding for PhD students, for postgraduate students, to go down to the classrooms, to observe, to work with the teachers and not on the teachers. Yeah. And And this is we live in a complex world. This is complex. It can be difficult, but I think it's not impossible at all. And in order to change these attitudes and change these ideologies, we do need time. And time does unfortunately cost some amount of money. Thank you very much.
Je reviens juste sur un point pour le souligner. Vous avez insisté sur l'importance de la première langue, mais et aussi sur le rôle des parents. Moi, j'habite dans une commune à Nanterre dans laquelle une bonne partie de la population ne parle pas, les parents ne parlent pas le français. Et donc, c'est aller vers les parents dans leur langue. Le problème, vous répondrez ensuite, mais j'y pense tout de suite. Est-ce que cela ne risque pas du côté des parents, de les ancrer dans leur propre langue, et donc un problème d'intégration. On a une vraie difficulté, donc il faudra peut-être qu'on réfléchisse là-dessus. Ça me paraît une question tout à fait importante. Madame Angela James, à vous la parole.
Angela James, merci. Goina, let's say I. Si c'est Angela James Soulier. My name is Angela James, and I'm from the Northwest Territories in Canada, way up where Santa Claus lives. And I'm part of the indigenous peoples of the Métis. I'm a Manitoba Métis. In Canada, there's three different indigenous groups. There's the First Nations, Métis as myself, and the Inuit people. And many of us indigenous people, what we do is we situate ourselves. We tell you a little bit about ourselves so you can understand it, so a little bit of personalization. I am a Manitoba Métis, I've been living in the Northwest Territories for the past 40 years. And married into a Chipewyan Dene family. In the Northwest Territories, there are Dene people who are the indigenous people, they're Inuit people, and there's also Métis people. And I've married into a Chipewyan Dene family. And recently, I've been an educator for 30 years, and just recently, I also gained the title of grandmother. My daughter gave birth to twins on March 15th, so I am very much in the mode of early childhood development. But I have, thank you. I have a couple of slides here, if I can get one out. So, and the second, this is just who I am, second one. So, just a little bit of contextual piece for myself is, in my Métis family, I'm the first person in my family to get a bachelor's degree, and then to get a master's degree, and then to get a doctoral degree. So I really believed in education as the grand equalizer, if indeed you reach for it. I had very strong grandparents, and they believed in me. I come from a home of poverty, of violence, and of alcoholism. And the fortunate thing in my life, though, is my mother quit drinking when I was 15 years old. And so that act of sobriety really helped me through my years in my education. After my education in the high school system, I traveled all the way up to the Northwest Territories 40 years ago. And I learned from the Dene, the Métis, and the Inuvialuit people in the Northwest Territories. And they very much are three different groups, as I said, the Dene, the Métis, and the Inuvialuit. And the Northwest Territories is known for its two curriculum that celebrate the Dene and the Métis and the Inuit way of teaching and learning, and that's the Dene Kadé and Inukharigit curriculum. The Northwest Territories is a very small jurisdiction, very small population base, but as I say to many, it is a microcosm of education in the whole of Canada, if I can say. But as well, it's a very large geographic region, probably the size of all of Europe, if I may say so. And in the Northwest Territories as well, we struggle with languages because there are 9 official Indigenous languages in the Northwest Territories. But in the Northwest Territories, it is said among the Dene, the child is born with a drum in its hand. The child is born with integrity. The child has worth. It is the birthright of the Dene child to be acknowledged and respected for this. The child who is not respected cannot become what the child is meant to be. And so those are that is the type of concept that I studied when I did my own dissertation. And this same curriculum called the Dene Kadé talks about the capable person. Next slide, please. This concept of a capable person is essentially in the traditional way or the indigenous way of raising children. You create the conditions for the child to become a capable person or a good person. In the languages, it's called déninaison, déninaison, or déninaison. I examined this concept in my own study. I actually put my dissertation onto a little postcard, and I have several copies. For those of you who'd like copies, I follow a conceptual frame of a teepee, because raising children was like raising a teepee in my gift of this conceptual frame. And I examined this concept in 2016 with 12 NWT Indigenous elders. And from them, I learned about raising children and how the Indigenous aspect of raising children was so very important. Some of the key understandings that I came upon was that in the growth and development of a capable person, we really have to understand the Indigenous values and beliefs and the ways of knowing that has space in our dialogue when we talk about equity and inclusive education. Educators really need to pay attention to some of these key understandings that I learned from these NWT elders about raising children. These were elders who became capable people in their own families, as well as they raised their children to be capable people, and as well they worked in the school system, and they brought their own indigeneity into the school system to go through the process of raising capable children. And some of the key understandings I learned from them are listed here. For example, we've said this throughout the talks that I've heard this morning and this afternoon about the very reverential attitude towards the child in Indigenous families. That parents are the first teachers, and we've said that in several of the other talks that I've seen. As well, I know this one very personally now, as grandparents. The grandparents' love, or elders' love between the grandparents and the child, is almost the same as a creator's love for all of humankind. And that in the Indigenous world, especially in this day and age, there's a critical importance of identity, of self, and making sure that we understand the grounding influences of the growth and development of a capable person. Those holistic beliefs are in that first circle that's on the right-hand side of the TP conceptual frame. And these grounding influences talk about self in terms of what we really concentrate a lot in the Canadian education system is the development of the mind and the body. But we forget about the other aspects. In Indigenous values and beliefs, we believe in the mind, the body, the heart, and the spirit. And so that holistic understanding is very important, as well as the relationality to people, place, and time. And as well, in the middle there, the spiral guides. Those are the continuous stories that I heard from elders about the importance of belonging, the importance of love, the importance of identity, the importance of culture, and the importance of languages in the growth and development of a capable person. Next slide. And so we have to understand that Indigenous-based philosophies and approaches need to be honored and acknowledged as we are developing children from in the home and going into early childhood centers and to the schools. So making sure that a home-school connection is first and foremost as we are developing children into becoming and growing into be capable people. Merci, merci, cho, kwayenaini. Thank you. Merci bien.
J'avoue que je vous aurais volontiers posé la question de la première langue. Parce que le respect des cultures, la langue inuite, la langue d'aîné, ce n'est pas ni l'anglais ni le français. Or, l'orateur précédent a dit toute l'importance de la première langue. Donc, je vous réinterrogerai là-dessus. Comment on joue de l'un et de l'autre ? C'est un vrai problème. Je ne joue pas la contradiction volontairement, j'essaie au contraire de creuser et de voir éventuellement les ambiguïtés entre les uns et les autres. Monsieur Thévenon,
Monsieur Soulage, merci. Merci de cette invitation à croiser les perspectives. Je trouve effectivement cette journée extrêmement intéressante parce qu'on a vraiment différents regards sur ces questions-là. Outre effectivement que, comme vous l'avez souligné, que j'essaye d'apporter mon expertise au Conseil de la famille, je dirais que ma qualité première, c'est d'être analyste ici dans cette maison à l'OCDE, mais dans le département des politiques sociales. Hein, donc, mon expertise est plutôt sur le champ des politiques familiales et des politiques en direction de l'enfance et pas forcément sur les questions d'éducation en soi. Mais évidemment, les perspectives se croisent. Alors, je vais inscrire mon intervention dans la lignée de ce qui a été dit dans l'intervention principale, et si je peux avoir mes diapositives, en partant la prochaine, en partant des constatations que l'on peut faire, d'abord en matière d'investissement de la part des gouvernements en direction des enfants. Le montant, ce graphique vous montre quel est le montant par enfant qui est dépensé par les gouvernements en fonction de l'âge des enfants. Donc, vous suivez pour chaque pays, c'est selon l'âge des enfants. Et vous pouvez voir que ce qui est assez saillant dans des pays comme la France ou comme l'Allemagne, alors vous avez des dépenses qui sont assez conséquentes au moment de la naissance, autour de la naissance, parce qu'il y a des assistances en matière d'aide financière en particulier. Et puis en bleu moyen, vous avez les dépenses en matière de services d'accueil de la petite enfance. Et vous pouvez voir que ces dépenses sont nettement moindres que ce qui est dépensé durant la petite enfance, moindre que ce qui est dépensé après, lorsque démarre l'entrée dans l'école formelle, à partir du primaire. Et vous voyez que les différences sont extrêmement larges selon les pays, mais dans un pays comme les États-Unis, vous voyez très bien que le déficit en matière d'investissement dans les structures d'accueil formelles en direction de la petite enfance sont extrêmement faibles. Et puis vous voyez que dans des pays comme l'Allemagne, l'investissement après la petite enfance se poursuit, alors qu'en France, on a quand même un déficit, enfin un niveau d'investissement en matière d'éducation qui est plus faible que ce qu'on peut observer, par exemple, au Danemark ou même ou en Allemagne en matière d'éducation. Donc voilà, donc quand même, dans tous les pays, on investit moins dans la petite enfance que ce qu'on investit plus tard. Deuxième diapositive, quel est le résultat de ce moindre investissement? Deuxième diapositive, s'il vous plaît. C'est aussi qu'on a, ce qui a été souligné très fortement, c'est qu'on a évidemment un accès au mode d'accueil formel pour les petits-enfants, pour les très petits-enfants, donc de moins de 3 ans ici, un accès qui est très inégal en fonction du niveau de revenu ici, et où on voit que les enfants qui appartiennent à des familles qui ont un revenu plus élevé ont à peu près en moyenne deux fois plus de chances d'avoir accès à un mode de garde formel avant l'âge de 3 ans que les familles qui appartiennent au niveau de revenus les plus faibles. Et c'est constant, avec des niveaux d'inégalité qui sont très inégaux, qui sont plutôt faibles dans les pays nordiques. En France, c'est assez large, mais en moyenne, un rapport de 1 à 2. Alors, voilà, donc on aboutit à une situation paradoxale qui a déjà été soulignée ce matin, c'est qu'on a eu dans les pays quand même des efforts assez importants pour accroître les modes d'accueil pour la petite enfance, pour accroître l'accès à ces modes d'accueil, mais qui ont tendance à bénéficier davantage aux enfants de familles aisées, à la fois financièrement et culturellement, et que du coup, on a une situation paradoxale parce que plutôt que de réduire les inégalités qui apparaissent très tôt dans la vie, elles ont tendance plutôt à les renforcer. Et donc, on mesure tout ce qui est attendu de la part de l'école maternelle, c'est non seulement de préparer les enfants à l'entrée à l'école primaire, mais c'est aussi de réparer et de réduire les inégalités qui se sont déjà formées très fortement avant 3 ans. Alors, ça exige d'avoir des politiques qui essayent de prévenir la formation de ces inégalités qui apparaissent très tôt, et puis certaines politiques qui répare aussi ces inégalités, notamment à l'intérieur de l'école, en essayant d'aider plus les enfants des familles défavorisées. Alors, pour réduire ces inégalités, il faut essayer d'en saisir les raisons. Alors, il y a déjà beaucoup de raisons qui ont été discutées. L'un des facteurs qui explique ces inégalités, qui vous sont illustrées dans cette diapositive, c'est d'abord que les politiques d'accueil de la petite enfance, dans beaucoup de pays, elles dépendent, elles sont de la responsabilité des autorités locales. Elles peuvent être financées par, au niveau national, mais le développement des services d'accueil est la responsabilité des autorités locales, et avec des politiques qui peuvent être extrêmement hétérogènes en matière de niveau d'investissement et puis en matière de type de services qui sont développés. Et donc on voit là tout de suite que les mécanismes comme on a en France de fonds d'action sociale ou les mécanismes de péréquation entre régions vont être des éléments importants pour réduire ces inégalités, pour compléter les investissements qui sont les moindres investissements qui sont effectués dans certaines régions. Ce qui était aussi important, c'est de s'assurer que les enfants de familles défavorisées bénéficient de plus d'efforts. Une illustration de ce type de politique qui est pratiquée par exemple en Allemagne de façon extrêmement... au Danemark. L'exemple que je vais prendre vient du Danemark. C'est à l'âge de 3 ans, l'acquisition dans le langage... Les enfants sont évalués en fonction de leur acquisition du langage. Et lorsque le test n'est pas très bon, les enfants, on octroie 15 à 30 heures de cours, d'assistance en langue aux enfants qui sont les plus défavorisés. Donc ça peut démarrer très tôt ce type d'assistance plus grande en direction des enfants les plus défavorisés. Le coût des modes de garde est aussi un facteur qui limite l'accès à certaines catégories de population. Par exemple, dans des pays comme l'Irlande ou les États-Unis, le coût net de la garde des enfants de moins de 3 ans peut atteindre 40% du revenu du ménage pour les ménages à bas revenus. Les facteurs culturels, on en a parlé déjà au niveau linguistique, mais il n'y a pas que l'aspect linguistique, il y a aussi les attitudes des familles vis-à-vis de qui doit garder l'enfant à un très jeune âge. En France, vous avez 24% des adultes qui pensent que c'est la femme qui doit rester à la maison quand l'enfant n'a pas l'âge d'entrer à l'école. Bon, c'est un niveau relativement raisonnable, mais pas dans un pays comme le Japon. Vous avez 44% des individus, des adultes qui pensent que c'est en priorité à la femme de garder l'enfant lorsqu'il n'est pas atteint l'âge scolaire. Enfin, vous avez la situation familiale aussi qui peut être un obstacle à l'accès à un mode de garde, puisque par exemple en France, ce qu'on observe, c'est que les enfants de familles monoparentales ont à peu près une fois et demie moins de chances d'avoir accès à un mode de garde que les familles avec que les enfants ayant deux parents à la maison. Et donc là, évidemment, les politiques d'accompagnement des familles deviennent un enjeu extrêmement important pour réduire ces inégalités. Et je vais m'arrêter là, car je crois que le temps qui m'est imparti...
Je comprends mieux, effectivement, la portée de ce que vous dites, parce que, puisqu'on est ici en traitement, le mot qu'on a cité, c'est le mot équité, vous êtes clairement pour un traitement inégal de situations inégales. Voilà. Je crois que c'est important parce qu'on est dans une société où le mot égalité est en train de perdre de son sens. Et je trouve qu'il est important de temps en temps de dire les choses à partir de données qui montrent bien qu'on ne peut pas dire aujourd'hui tous les enfants vont être traités tous au droit commun. Oui, sauf que les situations de départ ne sont pas les mêmes. Et on vient de le voir dans les trois expressions qui viennent d'être exprimées. Donc je vous remercie infiniment. J'espère que vous continuerez à donner quelques idées à notre gouvernement, mais Nathalie y a travaillé déjà depuis fort longtemps. J'ai l'impression d'ailleurs que vous êtes assez d'accord sur les propositions. Donc vous n'avez pas perdu votre temps, je pense. Voilà. Madame Rao, vous venez d'une autre culture en même temps. Et c'est ça qui est intéressant dans votre témoignage, puisque vous allez nous dire des choses que peut-être on n'entend pas habituellement. Alors je vous remercie.
Merci beaucoup. Je parle en anglais. Thank you very much for inviting me to be here. I'm very delighted to be here. I'm a researcher at the University of Hong Kong, and I do research in different Asian countries. And for us, we really admire the OECD countries. We aspire to have your budgets. We aspire to follow the OECD recommendations of investing 1% of our GDP in early childhood education. We read all your documents from all your countries, and we are very jealous of some of the big countries who do longitudinal studies, who are funded for 15 years. But today I'm going to talk to you about something from our region. May I have the first slide, please? I'm going to talk to you about some of our policies and how we have borrowed and adapted some of the policies from the more from Euro American context. So let me begin by telling you, the first slide, please. Let me begin by telling you a little bit about Hong Kong. I think you all must know where Hong Kong is. We were a British colony till 1997 and were returned to China, and now we're a special administrative region of the People's Republic of China. We have a very unique situation in which we have one country, two systems, political rule. So our education system is independent of that of mainland China. We're very small. We have a population of 7.3 million. We have a population that is aging, that is growing. So we're growing old, graying population. So we're very concerned about quality education. Because we want to maximize human capital. We heard from the other speakers. We are a high-income context. We do very well in the PISA. The TIMSS were in the top few percentile. We're very proud that through our school system, when we come to PISA or TIMSS, we have very low socioeconomic gradient. That means the difference between the rich and poor, not so much, but very bad at early childhood. We'll talk about that in a minute. We have a very high Gini coefficient. Dr. Alexandra just talked about Gini coefficient. Our Gini coefficient is 0.54, which is very high. That means there's a lot of disparity between the wealthy and the not wealthy. We do have poverty, just like we heard in high-income countries. We heard in one of the OECD countries, 1 in 7 children is living in a family of poverty. I think we also have high poverty rate for such a high income country. Maybe 1 in 10 children is living in a poverty context. Our population is 92% Chinese, 8% ethnic minority. So I'm going to talk about equity and quality with respect to this small population. A few more things about our policy context. The government believes that the responsibility for young children below 3 rests with the family, so we don't provide free services for 0 to 3. We provide free kindergarten education since September 2017 to everybody for 3 to 6. We have universal enrollment. Government believes that we should have equality of access to early childhood. That means regardless of your socioeconomic background, ethnicity, you should have access to quality education. Okay. So in our context, with that background, we have 3 groups of children that require special attention. One is children from with special needs. We have many children on waiting lists for specialized services. We heard from the doctor earlier that there are more children with autistic spectrum disorders. I think our medical services have improved. We have more children with special needs. We've learned from developed countries, which have tended to move from segregation to integration to inclusiveness. We kind of missed a few steps. We've gone straight to inclusive education. So we have some issues. We also have cross-boundary, what we call cross-boundary children. Because of some policies in the past, we had children from mainland China who were born in Hong Kong. And because they're born there, they have access to education and they're able to have permanent residency in Hong Kong. So these children spend 5-6 hours, preschool children, crossing the border, coming from Hong Kong to China because previously they weren't allowed to get education in China because they didn't have the hukou, but that's changing. So we're really concerned about these 200,000 children were born in a 12-year period, and they have access. Then we have the ethnic minority children, which I want to focus on. So this population, about 56% of these ethnic minority are Filipino and Indonesian women who are working as domestic help to let women work. But we have many, many South Asian families with children. They tend to be Nepalese, Nepalese, Pakistani, and Indian. And they tend to have very large families. And the language of official language in schools is Chinese. And these children struggle to learn Chinese. The government's policy is one of integration. They say that the children have to learn in Chinese. There's no maintenance of the heritage language. So what the government does is provide a lot of support for these children. Well, they were providing little support, but more support now for these children to learn Chinese. These children tend to not make it to higher education. They tend to be very disadvantaged. If some of you know Chinese, it's a very difficult language. There are many characteristics of the Chinese language that make it difficult for non-Chinese speakers. It's a tonal language. It's a logographic, morphemic language. It has a different language structure. And these children have lots of problems learning Chinese, so they don't do well in school. So can we go to the next slide? I just have a few minutes left. So what we have done is our group at the university tries to do research to influence government policy. One we found from other people, research also we synthesized, we found that there's not enough support for these children in schools through the kindergartens. But what was very nice is when we did our policy analysis, if you can see that little graph, we found that our government is going from equality to equity in its provision of support for children with special needs, children with from ethnic minority backgrounds, and boys who tend to do little less well than girls. And no government document says this, but they seem to be moving towards what the health economics calls proportionate universalism. So everybody is provided services so they can all do well and come up to a level. Thank you very much.
Je rebondis immédiatement sur ce que vous venez de dire. Qu'est-ce que vous en pensez de ce passage à l'équité? Qu'est-ce que vous pouvez en dire? Quelle est votre opinion sur ce passage? Vous l'avez souligné, mais c'est quelque chose qui vous paraît une bonne chose ou quelque chose qui mérite d'être discuté?
Something that should be discussed.
Oui, oui.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I think equity is a very good thing. I think equality is everyone getting the same amount, but equity is, I think, what we want as a value in our society. So I think this is a really wonderful way to move.
La réponse est claire. Merci. Alors, maintenant, on passe un peu à un moment de discussion, mais est-ce que l'un d'entre vous a des remarques à faire sur l'exposé initial de M. Alexander, par exemple? Est-ce qu'il y a des choses qui vous ont surprises, cette manière de prendre les questions du point de vue économique, qui n'est pas forcément habituel dans ce monde de l'éducation? Qu'est-ce que vous en pensez?
Aha.
C'est une question qui n'était pas prévue. Hein. Allez-y, je vous en prie.
Maybe I can say something. It reminded me a little bit of what has been said about the loss of languages in Canada, oui. Whereby I think it's the city of Toronto has been referred to as a linguistic graveyard. Because children come into school with all these languages, but after being in an English-speaking environment for so long, they lose their languages, and it's such a loss. And this is an economic loss as well, because these skills are highly needed. Highly skilled people with literate skills in these languages are really something that we need. Yeah.
I don't know whether I'm supposed to respond,
oui,
but one of the things we need to do, so Canada is a very diverse population, and about 80% of population growth now comes from immigration, and cities like Toronto are becoming more diverse. But you've picked up a downside of that, which is if the education system is forcing people through a program that's only English-oriented, You know, it can create learning challenges, it can create barriers to opportunity, it can set people back. The other thing is that we need to do a better job of actually taking advantage of the economic gains from diversity. And we see this in terms of employment, immigrants having lower than average employment rates. We also see it in terms of, you know, Canadian businesses taking advantage of workers with a broad set of skills that are outside of just, you know, their employment skills, like connections to other countries, language skills, terribly important. And if we're not valuing them properly, then absolutely there's an economic cost associated with them.
Oui, voilà une donnée qui est importante et qui confirme votre intervention sur la nécessité de respecter en partie, en tout cas, les langues qui sont les langues d'origine. Visiblement, il y a là quelque chose d'important. Oui, allez-y, je vous en prie.
C'était pour répondre à votre question aussi après mon intervention. I switched.
As you want.
The interpreters won't like me. the question of integration and the fear of communautarisme, I'm not even sure how to say it, communitarism in English, yeah? It's not absolutely necessary for professionals. Of course, it's impossible for us to speak all the languages of all the children. Some classes have, you know, 20 plus languages in the classrooms. That's not feasible. But it's not a question of learning all these languages. It's a question of taking a step towards people, smiling, using nonverbal communication, using gesture, but not being afraid to try and communicate and to use what linguistic skills you have in whatever languages you have in your repertoire. And maybe just to learn one or two words in the language of another person, maybe to be able to greet them, is already a big step, and it's a big sign, because integration, inclusion, it's not a one-way street. It needs to go in both directions. Yeah. And so if we don't welcome, how can we expect people to learn our language, learn our cultural codes, et cetera, et cetera? And also referring to this problem of language, it's not languages that are the problem. It's our way of looking at languages that are the problem. And children are very, very sensitive to this. And they feel when their adults around them that they hold in high esteem do not have a positive image of their language, of their culture, of their by association, their families. It can really harm their self-esteem, their identity formation, and their will to engage in learning.
Justement, Madame James, qu'est-ce que vous en pensez de ce qui vient d'être
dit? I really do think that equity in Canada really concentrates on making sure that we understand that it is not only the economic advantages that will aid Indigenous peoples, but we have to remember that in certain countries, such as Canada, the Indigenous people, that's their homeland. For example, the Northwest Territories, the Métis, the Inuit, and the Dene people have nowhere else to go and be Dene, Métis, and Iqaluit people. So the equity there is very much to make sure that the development of self and the culture and the language and the identity are all part of the education system, because they don't have anywhere else to go to be who they are in their own country. So that very strong point of education in the early childhood system, as well as in the school system, has to begin with the languages, with the cultural, with the traditions that are of the people, with the ceremonies and the protocols that are of the people, in order to have people in the Indigenous world come into their own as they were once before as strong nations in that past century. We learned from the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in Canada in 2015 is that the calls to action ensure that languages, that education, that the social justice system has to come forward and provide the conditions, create the conditions for Indigenous peoples to recover, reconcile and rejuvenate and reconcile revitalize their languages and their culture, and that takes time. It took a whole century to have Indigenous peoples in Canada lose their languages and lose their culture, and they're through a process right now of reconciliation, and that is a very important part of gaining the equity that's necessary for the Indigenous peoples in Canada.
Sur ces questions, Madame Noël, vous avez des choses à ajouter?
Parce que on vous a,
vous n'avez pas pu développer la totalité de ce que vous vouliez dire.
Because I feel like you still had other things to bring up on minorities precisely.
One of the things is that in many of your countries, there is a lot of respect for the heritage culture, and in Hong Kong, at least, it's a culture of assimilation. So we are very small, and the majority is Chinese. So there's no accommodation for diversity. The support that is provided is to help the immigrant integrate. Now, I know, like in Europe, there were lots of refugees that are coming from different parts of the world before. It seems that there are different kind of government policies. Like, you know, even when we have the immersion model of languages, there's different models. You know, there's usually mother tongue. UNESCO's talk about mother tongue. So I'm quite interested in that. But we don't have that. We don't have any attempt at preserving the native languages, all to assimilate and provide. Government will provide, if there are more than 8 children in who are ethnic minority, they provide extra teacher, they provide support. So it's a different philosophy of government policy.
Si je crois ce que dit Madame Young, donc vous courez un risque de perte d'efficacité économique.
You might lose in economic efficiency.
La logique du raisonnement qu'on vient de tenir. Monsieur Thévenon, il y a une chose qui m'a frappé dans ce que vous avez dit, c'est tout de même la grande hétérogénéité d'accueil, et notamment ce que vous avez dit sur les États-Unis. Comment vous expliquez cette grande différence entre la culture européenne et les États-Unis, justement dans l'accueil de la petite enfance?
A big disparity between services in the United States and in France.
Grande question. Il y a, je pense, plusieurs questions. Les États-Unis n'ont pas de politique basée sur des droits universels, comme nous on l'entend, avec un principe d'égalité, et comme vous l'avez rappelé, un principe d'égalité qui suppose qu'on a une politique pratiquement identique qui soit appliquée à tous les enfants et de façon universelle, c'est-à-dire la plus large possible. Les États-Unis eux ont ce paradoxe qu'ils savent mettre en place des programmes extrêmement efficaces qu'ils évaluent très très vite, ça fait partie aussi
ils évaluent
et puis il y a, disons, ils ont moins de problèmes éthiques. Parce que pour évaluer, il faut aussi accepter l'idée qu'on va faire bénéficier pour un certain temps de certains programmes à certains enfants, alors que d'autres, on va les sélectionner pour ne pas en bénéficier. Nous, c'est difficile de aussi concilier ça avec nos principes éthiques d'universalité. Donc il y a cette tension-là, et puis il n'y a pas ce principe, disons, d'égalité initiale, d'universalité, qui vient préempter les choses, et donc on a la possibilité de mettre en place des programmes à petite échelle, de tester s'ils fonctionnent, de voir quelles sont les conditions pour avoir des programmes de plus grande portée. Mais on a ce paradoxe où ils sont très bons pour définir des programmes locaux, mais en revanche, pour en faire des politiques générales, là, il y a un palier qui n'est pas franchi. Et du coup, au niveau agrégé du pays, on voit que globalement, la somme des petits programmes est parfois très efficace qu'ils savent mettre en place. Du point de vue national, ça ne fait pas une politique qui est d'envergure aussi grande que ce qu'on peut observer en France, ou dans les pays nordiques, ou désormais en Allemagne. Donc il y a des cultures au départ qui sont extrêmement différentes. Le rapport entre ce qui est est public et privé aussi est très différent. Hein. Nous, on a quand même, on hérite d'une culture où, disons que qui appartient à l'école, l'éducation appartient à l'école, mais disons les problèmes familiaux, je caricature à dessein, mais les problèmes familiaux doivent s'arrêter, et culturels d'ailleurs, doivent s'arrêter à la porte d'entrée de l'école. Il n'y a pas cette culture-là, que ce soit au Royaume-Uni ou aux États-Unis, voire je pense que cette dichotomie, elle est moins forte. Et que du coup, ça donne des programmes aux États-Unis où les home visiting programs, où voilà, on se permet d'avoir des travailleurs sociaux qui rentrent au foyer, dans les familles, pour voir comment ils fonctionnent, comment ils s'occupent des enfants, mais comment ils organisent leur quotidien. Je crois qu'on a on avait jusqu'à présent une certaine réticence à penser les choses comme ça, qu'il y a une possibilité de décloisonner un petit peu ce qui se passe dans l'univers des familles et dans l'univers public. Donc voilà, mais je crois qu'il y a des mentalités et des qui sont en train d'évoluer aussi en France. Peut-être que les mentalités se rapprochent.
Et au Canada, monsieur Alexander, comment ça se passe?
Getting closer to the US point of view. How do things, how do these things work in Canada?
Getting it from two sides. So from a Canadian point of view, there is enormous public support in Canada for having a public education system, that all kids should have access to a good quality public education system. And we have parental leave for the first year and a bit. But in between parental leave and the public education system starting, you have a gap. And in that gap, basically, it's up to parents to provide for their kids. And this is where you get to sort of the equality issue, that some parents are better able to provide support to their kids than others. And so wealthier families can certainly afford access to a high quality early childhood education program, but a lot of lower middle income or lower income families simply can't afford it. So there's a huge accessibility problem. And I think the challenge I run into when I advocate for more investment in early childhood education is that I run into a segment of the population that doesn't view early childhood education as education. They view it as babysitting. They view it as taking care of the child while the parents at work. They don't view it as actually education. And I remember doing a radio call-in show. You should never do radio call-in shows. And I was advocating for more investment in early childhood education. I had these people attacking me on the radio. And one of the guys said, like, I don't want my tax dollars going to fund these centers. You know, I walked past one of them today, and you know what those kids were doing? They were playing. And I don't want to pay for that. And so we do have a bit of a, you know, we're somewhere in between in the sense, like, it's not like it's a family issue, it's an education issue. I think my biggest challenge is trying to raise awareness that it's actually about education. It's about developing skills. It's developing children and their potential. And I think the more people I can convince of that, the more buy-in I get. There was a good question, though, about, should it be equality versus equity? And I guess my point is, it should be equity in order to get equality, right? And I think that what we have right now is a system that doesn't quite deliver that yet.
Alors, il nous reste. Merci beaucoup.
Thank you very much.
Je partage assez bien votre point de vue. Partir de l'équité pour aboutir à l'égalité.
C'est un programme en soi.
Pas évident. Il nous reste quelques instants. J'aimerais que éventuellement certains d'entre vous posent des questions à notre panel, mais pour qu'ils se préparent, je vais leur demander à chacun d'entre eux quelle est la mesure qu'ils prendraient.
First, I'd like to ask each one of you, which measure would you adopt in priority, something that to take with us from this workshop? And I'll let you think about that as we gather some questions from the audience.
Il est derrière vous, voilà, c'est ça, il arrive.
We had one question from the audience, and to simplify it, it says, you know, as elected representatives are very adept, or basically, as the world's shifting to simple answers to very complex questions. How do governments and spurs of early childhood investments make their case? The way I would do it is I would simply tie it to issues of the day that are of paramount importance. Right? So you hear people complain about income inequality, investments in early childhood education can help fix that. You're worried about the labor market and job outcomes, early childhood can help you fix that. You know, you invest in early childhood education, you increase skills. Well, people with stronger literacy are more likely to volunteer. They're more likely to make better health choices. They'll take pressure off the healthcare system. You know, they'll be more engaged on public issues. Take climate change. You know, I actually defy you to come up with a topic that I can't actually have essential skills help you solve. And early childhood education is about essential skills. So, you know, I find that what I do to advocate is not to advocate specifically for ECE. I basically help try to make the case that, yes, these are important issues of the day. By the way, this can help with that.
Monsieur.
Oui, simplement.
Yes.
Simplement pour ajouter un facteur qui contribue probablement à faire varier l'adoption de programmes à la petite enfance. Ce sont les structures politiques. Le Canada, comme les États-Unis, c'est un pays fondé sur les États, les provinces, qui ont la responsabilité de l'éducation. Donc, ça crée un contexte particulier.
Has the responsibility and the prerogative for education, and so it's quite different there. France is a centralized country, or somewhat
more
centralized,
at least.
And I think that this factor does make a difference.
Vous présentez globalement la situation au Canada, mais il y a énormément de variations selon les provinces.
You made a broad presentation, and there are disparities across provinces and across different regions, I believe.
Well,
we're not going to open this can of worms, because otherwise other people will not be able to speak. I would like to ask this question to all of you. What would you take away from this conference, from this Congress, so that tomorrow, when we sit down and think about what we did, what would
alors,
you say,
Madame Noah?
Madame Noah,
quelle est l'idée force
que what would you take away from this Congress?
What I've heard from other people, what their countries are doing, I think this idea of learning from each other, how to promote, how they tackle equity and quality. I haven't heard so much about innovation, but that, from what I've heard, how they're dealing with these issues, other contexts.
Thank you, Mr. Thévenon.
Alors, je garderai moi la perspective économique et pour insister sur le fait que, alors, je ne sais pas combien d'entre vous ont eu une formation d'économiste, mais moi, dans mon parcours d'économiste, on m'a toujours enseigné que dans la plupart des domaines économiques, il y a un arbitrage entre efficacité et équité. Et un point que fait remarquer très justement James Ekman, que vous devez connaître, c'est que la petite enfance, c'est peut-être le seul domaine économique où il y a une parfaite convergence entre équité et efficacité. Hein, parce que lorsque, j'ai montré dans mes diapositives que malheureusement les enfants de familles défavorisées ont un moindre accès aux structures d'accueil, mais lorsqu'ils en bénéficient, le bénéfice qu'ils obtiennent est beaucoup plus grand, ça nous a été rappelé ce matin, que pour les familles déjà avantagées. Donc il y a une espèce de convergence, voilà, et que ça converge avec l'efficacité, parce que ce qui n'est pas investi en fait dans la petite enfance va se transformer en inégalités qui vont être croissantes au cours du temps avec l'âge, des problèmes qui vont apparaître avec l'âge et qui soit seront impossibles à résoudre, soit les inégalités on ne pourra plus les réduire, soit les problèmes qu'on va rencontrer d'enfants qui sortent du système scolaire ou qui ont des troubles de comportement, on ne pourra plus le réparer. Et donc les dépenses qui peuvent être, enfin ce qui est investi initialement qui peut être considéré comme des dépenses, les bénéfices très vite vont apparaître à moyen et à long terme.
Un investissement social,
voilà. Et je pense que ce discours est important à tenir, parce qu'il y a un moment où les ministères de l'éducation vont devoir rencontrer le ministère des Finances et là on parle d'argent.
I'll just also use the example of what's happening in the Northwest Territories, as is happening in other jurisdictions in Canada, is realizing that for the equity to take place, a system that we have in other jurisdictions across Canada is that the early childhood system is still in a market economy. And that is something that is quite a concern across all of Canada. We're realizing the benefits, of course, of early childhood, the economic benefits across the socioeconomic, the cultural, the spiritual, in all areas there's benefits. And so essentially, if we can learn to, in our system, bring the system down from the school and bring it into the early learning in order to have that systemic approach, so there's not the barriers that are created in the early childhood system that exist, and I think in a lot of jurisdictions across Canada, if not the states and Europe, and then we start to realize the importance of that segment of our human growth and development in the early childhood, and not having to place a dollar figure on it as per the parents and the families who can access that very quickly, and then of course the ones that are left behind are the disadvantaged or the vulnerable families who do not receive the care that's necessary for early years. So essentially the big issue across our jurisdictions is taking early childhood out of that market economy and starting to have that universal approach towards early childhood.
Sortir. La chose est claire. Madame
Young. Very clear.
I have three. Very quick ones, though.
Vous êtes la dernière. Vous êtes
Thank
la dernière
you.
Pour toutes les gens.
So, one would be within the what we call right in France now. The référentiel de compétences professionnelles, so the framework for professional skills and competences for teacher education. I would like to see not just inclusion mentioned in this, but a specific reference to linguistic and cultural diversity, because inclusion is a big field, including learning difficulties, etc., and I think we need to be more specific. I would secondly like to see something included in the concours, because the concours has a big influence on our program. So, if there was something in the concours about this question, this would help a lot. Also, the question of co-education, homeschool relations, we say in English, yeah, I think should also be up there in those two areas. And the final thing would be, I think, investment in participatory research, so that researchers, professionals, and families can work together in a whole school situation as a community. And I think that might be the link to the next panel.
Voilà. Merci beaucoup. Je vais me faire gronder parce qu'on a dépassé
Thank
un peu
you.
Le temps.
Oh,
mais tant pis.
Merci en tout cas. Given, but, it was worth it, I'd say. Thank you very much.